started boxing through my granddad. My granddad used to run the amateur boxing club in Coventry called the Triumph ABC. And me and my brother used to go up and watch. And I was about six, my brother was about eight. And he just introduced me to start training at that young age one day. And I just took to it, and it never stopped, you know. I had a successful amateur career. I mean, I won four scoreboard titles. Which you can only win four scoreboard titles. I think I was the last person to do it. I won NABC titles, junior ABA finals, got to the ABA finals. You know, fought for England 20 times. So I, you know, just failed to make the Olympics in 1996, which I was actually in line for a wild card for. So I won a gold medal at the Liverpool Multinations. You know, and I got measured for the suit, which is quite, you know, the Olympics was the dream, you know, and that was, but unfortunately just I never got the wild card. The wild card went to the Russians. So the first year I went in the ABAs when I was 19, I lost to David Starry in the English finals. The next year I was badly robbed in the quarterfinals as well. And I was badly robbed, you know, but that's the amateur game. Oh no, sorry, that's a lie. Like the next year I lost to Wayne Alexander in the final. And then the year after that, I was killing myself to make the weight, but Wayne could hit like a hammer. The hardest punch I've ever been in with, you know. And then the year after that, I got beat in the quarterfinals by a very bad decision. But luckily, when I got that was the year they were selecting the Olympic kind of squad, really. And then in the crowd when I got beat was two of the understudy England trainers, and they seen how bad the result it was. So I then went to, I got selected for the Liverpool Multinations, which is where I went on to fight Svenotka. Got a bronze medal there, got the loss of it on Svenotka in the semi-finals. And from that, I got selected for the European Championships, which were the Olympic qualifiers in 1996. So my granddad was very much an amateur man. He didn't want me to go pro, and we'd never really spoke about it. But after being 22, going on 23 at the time, of not making the Olympics, I thought, well, to hang about for the next Olympics, I'd be too old to go pro. So, and a few people started getting in touch with me about going pro, obviously. And then so I went and sat down with my granddad, and we had a big argument. You ain't going pro, this and you. I said, look, what do you want me to do, granddad? No, in them days, there was no lottery funding. You know, you never got paid for being an amateur. You know, if you did, I'd have changed my thoughts. But I spoke to my granddad, and the next day, he said he agreed with what I was saying, he understood what I was saying, and he started looking into it. And we ended up going with Chris Salinger and Frank Warren. That's who I went with in the end. 14 Reading. On the undercard of Dean Francis, and I fought a kid, what's his name? Dennis Dooley. Yeah, I think he'd had two, won one, lost one. And I knocked him out in the second round. So it was a great start, you know, and very, very, very good start for me, and loved it, you know.
Heads coming a bit dangerously close together, and occasionally Doyley rather lunging in head first. There's a big danger of there being a clash of heads and a cut because of that. Oh, there's another left and a right hand, and that might be that. And it stopped without a count.
The amateur games changed a little bit now, but in them days it was 1,000 miles an hour, you know, and so when you go pro, you've got so much more time. You know, you slow it down a bit, you know, because you're working towards that 12 round, even though your first fight's only a 4-rounder, you work, you know, the game plan is to work towards a total contention 12 round fight, so you start your apprenticeship early as such, you know, and you just got more time, and you know, and from that time you develop more power, you know, and I was never a big puncher, but I could knock you out, but I think as a pro, the power developed a little bit, you know. Obviously, unbeaten growing through your career. You know, you're serving your apprenticeship, so you know, you're taking them stops and little steps between being a championship fighter. So really speaking, an intercontinental title shot is like it's a stepping stone to work your way up. And, you know, and the promoters I was with at the time, Lion Promotions, who basically sorry, Golden Fist it was, sorry, they changed the Lion Promotion, but Golden Fist, they're based in South Africa. But they were very well in with the WBU at the time, so obviously we did the title shot, you know. He was an awkward fighter, Jason, but he was out of the Ingle stable, but he wasn't an Ingle fighter, he was a high work rate fighter. And to be fair, when the fight came, the fight was in the December, I think it was, I'm sure the fight was in the December, and I fought in the October, and I knew the next fight was going to be for that fight against Jason Collins for the title, but he knew before as well, so he was training for a 12 round fight for 3 months, so was I, but so he was in great shape, so, and he was awkward, and he came to fight, and the Ingles had knew me since the amateur days, so they knew how to kind of beat me or try and beat me, you know, and he made it a difficult fight. I won on points, but it was an awkward fight because of his style, but you know, I probably tried too hard because it was my first title shot, you know. But it's gaining the experience. As long as you're winning, you can learn from it. As long as you're not getting that defeat, you know. And, I mean, I won quite convincingly, but it just wasn't my best performance.
Good right hand from the man from Coventry. Collins immensely strong.
Yeah, better from Bendall. Now he should move.
Hard-pressed referee has to break them up. Better from Bendall. Huge Coventry support here. Away with the right hand. Bendall has taken all of those shots, so he can certainly take a punch. And that's it all over. They both think they've got it.
I defended it in South Africa. I defended it over here. Then I won the IBO Intercontinental as well. Defended that twice, and then I fought Lee Blundell in a final, in a British title final eliminator, yeah, and then from that, then after Lee Blundell, I fought Mike Algo, which was another difficult fight, because I put myself under too much pressure there. But then, yeah, obviously, then the Scotland fight, I got made mandatory to fight Howard Eastman, to be fair. That was how it went. But at the time of being made mandatory to Howard Eastman, we lost our TV contract, and my promoters folded. And Howard and Scott Dan had just been beat by Howard Eastman. I think he lost in 4 rounds. But he dropped Howard Eastman on the way, but then he got stopped. But so in the year, because we lost our TV contract, I had nothing. I know in the year going into fight, Scott Dan, I never fought. You know, in the same year after he got beat by Howard Eastman, he had 4 fights. You know, and because of what was going on at the time, I put myself under so much pressure to win, I didn't perform, you know, and Scott Dan beat me. Donald Smiling in Coventry, in my hometown, my original hometown. You know, that was, again, that was good for me. He came prepared, again, trained by the Ingles. So they know how to fight me. And I stopped him on the car and cut eye in the third round. But it was, you know, it was good. First 2 rounds were good, but I was cut, he was cut, but I troubled him in the third round, and he was cut by the ref stopped it. Yeah, it was actually, yeah, nice kid wearing it, but again, it's frustrating, you know, I never turned up against Wayne, and I just put myself under so much pressure to win once again, and just never turned up, you know, and fair play to Wayne, lovely kid, he said to me after the fight, he said, I got lucky tonight, Steve, you never turned up, but that's boxing, when you're fighting, you and your opponent, if you don't turn up, you get beat, that's boxing. A lot of the times, When I got the big shots, the British title shot, Wayne Alcock final eliminator, not so much the European title because I called in late for that, I didn't perform. You know, and that's the difference with boxing, win them fights and then you the paydays come. You know, and unfortunately, I never got the paydays. Obviously, probably my most prolific win was beating Paul Smith. I wouldn't necessarily say it was the best win, but it's the most notable win because of what he what he was at the time, what he came on to do. But I don't think it was the best win. I think I fought better. And
Smith ütőre nyilvánvalóan nagyobb, csak ezt nem tudja kiaknázni. Bendall egyenlőre az esetek többségében megoldja azt a problémát, hogy távol tartsa magától Smith-t.
Kicsit fejetlen.
Hopp, azt hittem Smith még a... Hoppá! A mérkőzés vezető úgy...
I went there as a learning fight for Paul Smith, as a stepping stone for him to bigger and better things for him. You know, and they never expected me to beat him. You know, and to be fair, we trained in a way to box him, but when we got in there to fight him, I realised he wasn't as strong as I thought he would be, and we changed our tactics, and he didn't like me on him. And that's what won me the fight. I made him fight, and that's what won the fight, really. He would have given me that rematch, but the problem was, when I was training for the rematch, I broke my foot, which put me out. I couldn't do nothing for 4 months. And then I got a phone call, you've got 8 weeks to get fit, you're going to get stripped of your title, and I ended up fighting Dan McDermott. I lost on points, which a fight, I don't think I lost, still don't think I lost. But I blew up in the last 2 rounds, because I hadn't done nothing for 4 months, and then I had 8 weeks to get fit for a 10-round fight. I just blew up in the last 2 rounds, which won him the fight, I think. I thought I won it, and people in the crowd thought I won it, but that's, again, that's boxing. The border control took my losses off me, you know. Don't get me wrong, if I had a problem with a brain scan, I'd have jacked. But they weren't giving me a big enough reason, and I went and seen a specialist, and they said there was nothing wrong. So, but we put the report into the Border Control, and they said, look, we ain't giving you a license. So I can pass a boxing medical anywhere in the world, but the Border Control won't give me a license. So we went and got a license through Croatia, and I took a chance on fighting Dominic Bridge, because I hadn't fought for 2 years, and we see, but I have to take a chance and try and get somewhere. And again, I thought I won the fight. Lost on points, but that's, I was going to have to knock him out to win in Germany.
He's grown in confidence now, Steve. Yeah, he's competing on pretty equal terms at the moment, that's isn't right. he? And as we know, Steve, when you fight in Germany, sometimes when you fight a German fighter in
Yes, they've handled that swelling well underneath the left eye. That would have been, of course, the end swell that did that. Those that don't know an end swell, it's a solid silver, exposed at any level, really. But especially when you're protecting a 24-fight record.
That's right. And he's still, dare I say, he's 23 years of age, still fairly new to the game.
Yep, and...
He was too big, we took a chance, because obviously I couldn't get any fights over it, so we had to just take a chance and take a risk, and like a fool, I'd signed contracts at 12 stone 4, even though he was a super middleweight at the time, but the contract was signed at 12 stone 4, he came in at 12 4, I came in at just under 12 stone, I'd have went to the ring at 12 stone 4, he'd have went to the ring about over 13 stone, he was just too big, and for the first 3 rounds it was a fight. But then the size just got on top, and I got dropped in the fourth round, got up, boxed on, but the referee stopped it. But it was just too big, no complaint.
Oi!
When I fought in Denmark against Rudy Markusen, Ryan Barrett fought on the same bill, and we became quite good friends, you know, and he knew the situation was going on, and a guy who was kind of promoting him, because Ryan was in a similar situation himself. I think he'd been banned by the border control for an energy drink called, I can't remember the name now, they talk about it when you go into border control meetings. And he failed a drugs test because of it, so he wasn't allowed to fight. So this as arose, and me and him went over there before for the abuse. And we used it as a stepping stone, well, I was hoping to use it as a stepping stone, really, to go on to bigger fights. You know, and so I went over there and stopped. You know, the kid was all good, he was strong, and I stopped him in 4 rounds, was it 5 rounds?
Six.
It was nice. Again, I've been out of the ring. It wasn't a bad performance, but I was using it as a stepping stone. You know, I was meant to fight in the February again in Germany, which fell through. Then we were fighting in Bournemouth. We'd been doing a deal to put our own defend my time in Bournemouth, which was massive for me. But then the promoter turned out to be a con man. You know, and that fight never happened. But he kept a lot of the ticket money. But yeah, and since then, nothing's ever came up. If I got a phone call and they gave me 12 weeks notice and the deal was right and worth it, I'd take it. Because, you know, the important thing for me is if people would have seen me 2 weeks before the show should have happened in the April in Bournemouth, if you'd have seen the shape I was in, because I've been training for 6 months for the fight in December, then we had meant to fight in February, then we meant to fight in March. Then the show got in March, got put back to April. So I'd been training non-stop for 6 months. If people would have seen the shape I was in, I had three sparring partners in here. Okay, they were inexperienced lads, but they're my pros. And I was doing 12 rounds straight off, and they were in and out. People would have seen the shape I was in, they went, he's still got it. The unfortunate thing is I never got the chance to show that, you know, and to get that kind of shape back would take me 6 months. You know, so you have to be a realist. Probably the Liebland-Blundell fight, really, but also fighting in South Africa on the undercard of Baby Jake McLala's last ever fight, and it was the same venue where Lennox Lewis fought Haseem Rahman. You know, I was out there for 3 weeks, you know, living there, you know, and. You know, I had 12 people come over and watch me boxing from England, Coventry, to watch me fight, and that was a great experience. You know, even though it wasn't the biggest arena I fought in, it was a fantastic arena, the way it was set up. It was built for boxing. You know, and obviously with having the stigma of Lennox Lewis fighting there as well, and the whole bill was all full of championship fights. And myself and David Starry fought on the bill. Gary Delaney fought on the bill, he fought Sebastian Rothman, you know, and then obviously you had the South African world champions fighting. So that was a great memory for myself. My hardest fight, as in, to me though, well, it was just hard, was Rudy Marks, but that was just because he was too big, but you know, hard. I mean, obviously, Paul Smith was a hard fight with a win, you know, because it was a toe-to-toe war, you know. Then, but like I say, Scott Dann and Wayne Alcott bashed me up, really. But I never turned up, yeah. You know, so, you know, I never look at them fights because it wasn't me. I don't, you know, if you're in there in a fight and you're performing and they're performing and you're getting nowhere, then it's hard to, in my eyes, it's a hard fight, you know, which was against Rudy Marks, and that was what happened, because I gave him hell for two to three rounds, but his size just took its toll, and eventually when he dropped me, I got back up. I mean, even when he dropped me, because it wasn't so much the power of the shots, it was just the accumulation. Boom, I was on the floor. What form am I doing? And if I wasn't, I've been hurt more and fought on, but it was just, it just took its toll.
Yeah.
You know, but it's hard to say, really. You find yourself, you know, as a boxer, you know, you maybe you haven't achieved what you should have achieved, or you haven't made the money you should have made, and then you think, well, what do I do? You know, you give your whole life up for boxing, and you kind of go, well, what do I do now? I don't want to go and be a labourer and earn rubbish money. You know, you got to think about, eventually you have to start thinking about life after boxing, you know. And at the time when I started to do this 7 years ago, people around me and people in someone around Coventry, he was doing it and making a very good living out of it. And obviously the people I know down here who were doing it and still doing it now and making good living off, well, I'll be mad not to, you know. It's just gradually on the keep fit and the gym side, that's what I started doing. But obviously from doing that, you know, my life has been boxing, you know. And gradually I went and got my pro trainer's license. My first pro was Jake Gosling, who never fought as an amateur, but just came and trained with me. But I could see his potential in there. He's now 6-0 as a pro, and now I've got a stable of three fighters at the minute. I'm also now a manager, you know, and I've got two more fighters coming in February, at least, possibly three. That gives me a good stable. Now on November the 20th, we're doing our third show in Bournemouth, working with Warrior Promotions from London, Mo Pryor. No, so it's just building all up, you know. And like I say, it's getting there slowly. So obviously, if I can build up a stable of pro fighters to work alongside my gym on the fitness side, and we should, you know, then hopefully, eventually, I'll make more money out of boxing, because I should have made.
All three judges are in favour of, and the new WBU Continental Middleweight Champion, Steven Bendall.
Well, the pride
and
of Coventry, Steve Bendall.
For a very
two judges gave it to him by four rounds, which was pretty
Jason
fair. One
Collins.
Judge gave it to him by eight rounds, which did not do Jason Collins much of a service at all. Richie Woodall, you had it four rounds to Bendall.
Yeah, that's how I saw it.